Hi, my name is Roman Nurek from the Android team at Google, and in today's DesignByte, I'd like to talk to you about how screen pixel density affects your workflow as an Android app designer. Let's take a look. So the first thing to understand is that Android devices come in all shapes and sizes, and the screens on these devices have different pixel densities, and this number is measured in dots per inch, or DPI. And these pixel densities simply say, you know, in a given square, say, inch of space on the screen, how many pixels will fit in. And this determines very much the kind of the level of crispness that you're going to see graphics and text and things like that on that screen. So in this example, here are a couple of different DPI values, possible DPI values, and how text, in this case the letter A, would be rendered on those screens. You'll notice that on the higher density screens, the letter A is rendered in a much more crisp, a much more almost correct representation of the letter A than on the medium density screens on the left. Now, as a designer, these pixel densities like 165, 234, and so on could be very cumbersome to work with. So fortunately, Android has created something called logical pixel densities, or buckets of densities, that the real densities would fall into to simplify things. And so here on screen, you see a couple of the most important logical densities that you as a designer would have to work with. So something like if a real device had 165 DPI screen, that would be mapped down to 160 DPI. And then everything that you would do from that point on, you wouldn't have to worry about the 165 number. You simply think about, oh, this screen I will treat as a 160 DPI screen. And 160 DPI is a special value. It's something called the baseline density on Android, where everything, and specifically the density-independent pixel units we'll talk about in a second, where everything is based on this baseline density. So that's 160 DPI. At the other far end of the spectrum currently, the highest number, the highest logical density, is extra high DPI, or XX HDPI, which is 480 dots per inch. And so there are four specific densities between 160 and 480 that you should really be aware of. That's 160, 240, 320, and 480. Now, there are a couple that are not listed here. There's LDPI at 120 and TVDPI at 213, but those are less common, and you generally don't need to worry about those. So now that we understand density, let's now talk about something that's critical to designing for Android, and that's the density-independent pixel unit. Now, density-independent pixel units, which are sometimes abbreviated as DP or DIP, sometimes referred to as DIPs in conversation, they're a virtual pixel unit, and they're equivalent to one physical pixel. That's one physical pixel on the screen on a MDPI or 160 DPI screen. And now, if you have, you know, a single density-independent pixel on a MDPI screen, that's one physical pixel. But if you're on a larger screen, let's say an XHDPI screen, it's actually four pixels, two across and two down. So why do we use density-independent pixels? Well, the reason for that is that we want to make sure that when we create layouts and overall kind of define the user interface for our application, we want to make sure that that UI elements remain the same physical size approximately across devices with different densities. We don't want to have to specify for each individual density what the sizes of our UI elements should be. So let's look at an example. So here we have 200 DIPs, and again, DIP units or DP units keep things roughly the same physical size across devices. So we have 200 DP units, and we have, let's say, this wide purple rectangle that's spanning across a couple of devices. Now, on an MDPI device like the tablet you see here, 200 DPs will actually result in something that is 200 pixels tall. So again, one DP is one pixel at MDPI. Now, on an XHDPI device like this Nexus 4 here, the 200 DPs will actually become 400 pixels tall. And this is actually built-in behavior. If you specify that something should be 200 DP, it'll be the same physical size on different devices. Now, one interesting thing about DP units is that since they're the same physical size across devices, we can start representing physical objects in terms of DPs. So for example, the fingertip, the human fingertip, is about 50 DPs wide. Now what that means is that when you are sizing your buttons and other UI elements, you want to make sure that things don't get too small enough to touch. You want to make sure that they're about the size of a human fingertip so that a regular person could comfortably press that button without making too many mistakes. So let's look at some math that'll help us get comfortable with converting between pixels and DP units. Now, here's the only real formula you need. To solve for one of the variables, you simply plug in the other two. So let's look at some examples. So here's the definition of DPs. One pixel is one dip, or one dip is one pixel at 160 DPI. Easy enough. Now, on a 320 DPI screen, one dip is actually two pixels across and two pixels down. So let's actually put this equation in practice and look at a quick exercise. So, how big is the 2013 Nexus 7 screen in density-independent pixels? Now, the information we have is that we know that the screen is 7 inches across diagonally. We know that it's an XHDPI screen, meaning it's a 320 DPI screen. And we also know that the screen resolution is 1920 by 1200 pixels. And so the first thing you may want to ask yourself is, what information here is necessary? Now, the fact that it's a 7-inch screen here is not actually necessary. To calculate the number of density-independent pixels, we don't actually need the diagonal screen size if we have the number of pixels and the density. So if you look at the formula from before, you'll notice that the ratio between XHDPI and MDPI is 2:1. So to convert from pixels to DP units on an XHDPI device, you simply divide by 2. And so the answer here is 1920 divided by 2 by 1200 divided by 2, or simply 960 by 600 density independent pixels. So you may be asking, what's the point of this calculation? Well, the reason is that density independent pixels better capture device physical screen size. Pixels could be the same across devices of different screen sizes. For example, you can have a medium density tablet at 1280 by 800 pixels and an extra high density phone at 1280 by 720 pixels, and their screen resolutions and pixels are almost the same. But that same phone will actually have a much smaller screen resolution when looked at in terms of density independent pixels. And so density independent pixels better capture that. So with that, let's move on to some quick tips before we sign off. So first, remember to design and spec all of your layouts in terms of arrangement of UI elements, the sizes of elements, the positions of elements. Make sure to spec that all out in DP units. It's going to make it a lot easier for your developers to implement things correctly. Second, remember that because there are a number of different densities, for optimal crispness of assets, you want to make sure that you provide those graphic assets, those PNG files, in all the different densities. So here's an example of a share icon. You want to make sure that you're providing it in 4 different densities, if possible. An XXHDPI all the way down to MDPI. And to do, again, the calculation for the sizes of these things, you simply use the formula that we used before. So if we know that we want to have a 32 DP square icon, we'll know that on an XXHDPI device, the asset you need for that should be 96 by 96 pixels. So that's it on today's DesignByte on how screen density, and specifically density-independent pixels, should affect your workflow as a designer. Stay tuned for more DesignBytes on how to put this into practice in tools like Photoshop and Illustrator and so on. Thanks.